be in the house of the Lord, isn't it?
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are delighted to be in this place this morning. It is the desire of our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth. We believe with all of our hearts that you alone are worthy of our praise, of our adoration, of our honor, of our worship. We ask you to please take over the service, the praise and worship team, the congregation, the announcements, the music, the offering, the baptism, the message that you have laid on my heart. God, we lift you up this morning, and we want to bring glory and honor to your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Please rise and join us in singing with all your heart to our awesome and good Father.
It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's
Before you take your seats, please greet one another in the Lord.
So don't forget about the recording, yeah? You had a good rest last night?
Oh, yes.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Hi, friend. Hi, Brian. Good morning, Bonnie. Nice to see you. Hi, handsome. I forgot your name. What's your name?
And then Gavin.
Gavin, yes. Okay, well, good morning again. It is so good to see each and every one of you today in the house of the Lord. Today is a great day, number one, because it is the first day of the week. It is Sunday, and on the first day of the week on Sundays, we gather together as a church, as a body of Christ, to worship Christ in this church, and this is why this is a great day. And second of all, this is a great day because today is Baptism Sunday. We have seven people who want to publicly profess that Jesus Christ is their personal Lord and Savior. And I am excited about them, and I am sure that each and every one of you are excited about them as well, aren't you? So I would like to invite them all now, all seven of them, to please come up. I want you to see them. I want you to meet them. These guys are experts on the topic of baptism. I want you to know that. They told me I can ask them any question I want, and they will. No, I just love these people. Before I would let them share with us their names and something about their life, their testimony, I do want to kind of get things started and warm them up a little bit, ask them a few things about baptism. We spent a couple of Sundays just talking about salvation, just talking about baptism, and I want you to know that none of them would be here this morning up on the stage if I wouldn't have believed with all of my heart that all seven of them have a testimony and they know exactly what they are doing, okay? So just want to ask them a couple of questions about baptism. Can any of you tell me what is baptism? When you think of baptism, what is baptism? Yes, Mason, go for it, man. Say that again. Amen. Very good. Mason says that baptism is showing people, or it is a picture of what God has done in our lives. Amen? So in a sense, like Mason said, it is a symbolic act, right? That a new Christian identifies himself with Christ's death, with Christ's burial, and with Christ's resurrection. Amen? Here is another question. One of you please answer this. Is baptism necessary for salvation? Do you need to be baptized in order to be saved?
No, you don't.
Dorothy says no.
No.
Absolutely no, right, Dorothy?
Right.
What is necessary for a person to be saved? What is required by God for a person to be saved? Any of you? Yes.
You have to accept him into your heart.
Amen. You have to accept Jesus Christ into your heart as your personal Lord and Savior. It is another question, and the last one, who can be baptized? Obviously, we do not baptize babies because we believe that baptism, when you look into the original, into Greek, it means it's the Greek word baptizo. It means to immerse, to dip into water. We dedicate babies to the Lord. We believe that if a baby dies, if it's unfortunate and a baby dies, they go to be with the Lord that very moment because they are innocent. We baptize mature people. So who can be baptized? Who can we baptize? Yes.
People who know what they're doing.
Exactly. People who know what they are doing. Do you guys agree with that? Exactly. People who have repented of their sins and confessed Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Very good. Now I'm going to... And we as a church, we are going to hear from you a little bit. I'm going to start with Dorothy, and we can go down the line. Tell us something, whatever is on your heart, for a few seconds.
I'm being baptized today because I was sprinkled in a Catholic church as an infant. And this is something I've always wanted to do. And I can't think of a better place in this country to do it than this little Baptist church. I just love it here, and I feel so accepted and so welcome here, and I definitely want my baptism to be here.
Amen. Thank you, Dorothy, and we are proud of you. Amen, church? You're next, buddy.
I am Josiah, and I've been wanting to get baptized since I was 6 or 7, and then we came to this church, and I decided that I was going to do it today because of the class that Pastor John had, and it really inspired me to get baptized.
Amen. Thank you, Josiah. We love you, and we are proud of you. You can give it back. Yeah.
I accepted Jesus into my heart when I was little, and I was having Bible class with Kay, and I wanted to get baptized, and I hadn't really gotten a chance, but now I have. So I'm just happy I'm doing this.
That's awesome. We are happy for you also, Mason. Thank you so much.
My name is Oshana Todor, and I'm going into fourth grade. I'm here today because one day my dog ran away and I was very sad about it. And that's when God reminded me that I was a sinner and I trusted him as my Lord and Savior. And that's why I'm following him through water baptism.
Amen. Thank you, Oshana.
My name is Noelle Donner, and I actually came to Christ in this very church at VBS when I was 5. And I just really wanted to do this to show everyone how much I love God.
Amen. Thank you so much.
My name is Noah Donner. I was saved at about 3 and 4. And I was saved at my house. And me and my siblings decided that we were going to get baptized together. So.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Noah.
I'm Natalie Donner, and I was saved when I was little, but I didn't fully feel like I was until I was like in middle school, and then I had this awesome revelation, and I really started coming to Christ then. So I decided that I was given the opportunity to get baptized, so I decided that I would do that.
Amen. Thank you so much, Natalie. Isn't that awesome? Yes. Do you guys have any questions? You got 2 seconds. No, you don't. Okay. Well, let's pray and then we'll get it done. Father, we are just in awe of you. We are in awe of you, God. In awe of your power to save people. Jesus, you tell us in your word that when you will be lifted up, you will draw all men unto yourself. And God, we believe as a church with all of our hearts that these 7 people have been drawn unto you by the power of your Holy Spirit. God, we pray as a church that you will bless them, that you will protect them, that you would put on their hearts never to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that in return, they will share Christ with their friends, with their schoolmates, with their neighbors, and make disciples, and help expand the kingdom of God. God, we pray now as a church that you will bless the baptism act that is about to take place in a few moments from now. God, thank you for the privilege that you are giving us as a church, as the body of Christ, to be able to fulfill your command, to make disciples, and to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We pray all of these things in the wonderful name of Jesus, our precious Lord and Savior, and all God's people say, Amen. Okay.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red in my sin.
Church, I have here next to me Dorothy Warden. Dorothy, I would like to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior.
Yes.
According to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I'm in this, cleansed by His blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we trust. I'm some of the family of God. I have here next to me Elshana Todor. It is my privilege this morning not only to be her pastor, but also to be her father. Elshana, I would like to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior.
Yes.
Well, according to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Amen. I have here next to me a very, very cool young man, Josiah Tillander. We are just so happy for Josiah and his family. A lot of family members from his father's side and his mother's side are here with us this morning. Josiah, I would like to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior.
Yes.
Well, according to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, I also baptize you this morning in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath his cleansing flood. Amen. Another cool young man. Isn't that amazing? Mason Gerking. Mason also has family members worshiping with us this morning. Mason, we are happy for you. I also want to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior.
Yes.
Yes, he is. Praise the Lord. Well, according to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, Mason, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Reading how I love to proclaim it. Sing it, church. Reading on blood of the Lamb. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. Noah Donner is right here next to me in the water of baptism. As you can notice, most of the kids that I'm baptizing this morning are as tall as I am. And I am sure that pretty soon they are going to be taller than me. But God is good. Noah, we are very happy for you. Your mother is here, your father is here, your siblings are here, your grandmother is here, grandmothers. It is an awesome day, isn't it? Amen. I would like to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Savior, and if by faith you also repented of your sins and have trusted Christ as your Savior.
Yes.
Well, Noah, according to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, it is my privilege this morning to baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, thy great salvation so rich and free. I have here next to me Noelle Donner. Noelle is the sister of Noah. All the three of the Donner kids are getting baptized this morning. And Noelle, I also like to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior.
Yes.
According to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's sing that chorus again. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for Thy great salvation so rich and free. Natalie Donner is next to me into the water of baptism. Natalie, we are also happy and thankful to the Lord for the work that Christ has done in your life and in your heart. I would like to ask you if Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior as well.
Yes.
According to the Lord's command and upon your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
So now I have to follow up with announcements. As you can see, the food shelf needs are there, and there is a space in the foyer to put those items. The Kasson Street Assessment Project is right there. If you want to contribute to that, that would be greatly appreciated. Youth group will meet this Wednesday from 6:30 to 8, and then also prayer service for this Thursday as well. Sunday school will be promoted. You guys are going to be promoted up to the next level. So that means I'll have maybe more than one or two students in the youth group. That's great. Wednesday, September 6th is ARC leaders meeting at the church. I think some of you already have decided you want to lead, but if others still want to be part of ARC this season, please contact Lori. I'm sure she would. There's definite need for help. Sign up in the foyer? Thank you. Okay. And then ARC will kick off, which is Always Reaching Kids. We'll start, the registration starts September, or the time will start, excuse me, it will kick off on September 13th. Please register online. There are still plenty of seats open. And then finally, the last two things regarding with the men of the church and the women of the church. There is a fishing retreat Saturday, September 8th and 9th at 5 p.m. at Bass Lake Camp. And then the women's annual fall trip to Landsboro is also happening September 23rd. And registration is still happening, Marsha?
Yeah.
Okay, still sign up. There is still room. So I will close with prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this day and what you've brought before us, Lord. Seven individuals who want to publicly proclaim how you've inspired them, Lord, how you've changed their lives, to allow them to come forth in this place and be baptized, Lord. We also lift up the people of this church and the people of the U.S., Lord, especially in Texas, Lord, as they are responding to such horrible rains and this storm Harvey, Lord. Let be with the responders, Lord, the police, the fire department, all of the citizens and those that have decided to stay, Lord. Let them be safe. Let people be able to respond to them quickly, and let there be funding available for them, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this day that you've brought us to, all the people around us, Lord. Be with them as they go out in this day. Help them seek you, Lord, in every situation that you bring forth to them. We thank you, Lord, for this offering, our tithes that we can give to you is such a small sacrifice to the greatest sacrifice your Son provided to us. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Still and wait here in the silence.
until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more.
As we sing number 493, Glory to His Name. Saved from sin, Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in, glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name.
my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad that I entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
Please be seated. Children dismissed for Children's Church.
Indeed, glory be to his name. Amen. I do want to have a word of thanks. First of all, thanks to the Lord. And second of all, I want to thank our deacons. A lot of their work is behind the scenes at this church. A lot of things are happening at the church, keeping the grounds well-maintained and the building well-maintained. And I want to thank our deacons for their faithful work here at the First Baptist Church. And in this particular case, for getting our water ready and getting it warm. It was so nice you could have even swum into it. Thank you so much, guys. You're doing a great job. And of course, our deaconesses who helped with the people as they were coming out of the water. Thank you. And then I also want to thank you guys. I want to thank the Sunday school teachers, the people that you've seen up in front a few moments ago. First of all, they are the result of the work of the Holy Spirit that he's done in their lives. But second of all, many of you have invested into those people that were up on the stage. And I just want to say that your work is not in vain. That Sunday school class that you teach, that ARC night that you are faithful to come throughout the ARC season, Wednesday after Wednesday, that youth class, you know, that you minister to the youth throughout the week, it is very, very important to the body of Christ. Thank you again for a job well done. And thank you to the parents who have invested into these kids and into these people by teaching them the way of the Lord. An excellent job. Amen. Well, I'm going to share with you, I'm not going to call it a sermon this morning. You don't mind, do you? I love preaching the Word of God, as you know, but this is a special day, and that in itself was a sermon, what you saw a few moments ago. So I'm not going to share a 40-minute sermon like I usually do as I preach the Word of God, but I am going to share with you a few nuggets from the Word of God. I have a message that contains both a challenge and an encouragement, okay? And I don't think that you can have Baptism Sunday unless you emphasize salvation. And I'm going to give you a heads up of what this message will be about. This message will contain nuggets about what salvation is and how can a person can come into a relationship with Christ and live a life that is pleasing to God. Before I do so, I want to give you a heads up, a looking ahead. Last Sunday of August, man, I cannot believe it. September, October, November, this 4 more months and we'll finish the year. So I want to show you in the next 4 months about what I feel that the Lord had laid on my heart to share with you for the next 4 months. Well, in the month of September, we are going to continue with a series of messages, Jesus and Your Problems. We talked about different problems and trials that we encounter in our Christian walk, in our journey here on earth as Christians. And the last sermon that I preached as part of the series was a sermon on depression. I was only able to cover part one of that sermon, and Lord willing, next Sunday, I'm planning to do part two. So for the month of September, I'm going to continue with the series of messages, Jesus and Your Problems. Plan to be with us. And then, as you know, next Sunday, which is the first Sunday of September, it is the Sunday before the children go back to school. You know, the elementary kids and kindergarten and high schoolers. I believe colleges went back to school. But next Sunday, since it's the Sunday before the kids go back to school, we do this every year. We dedicate our children to the Lord and concerning the school year that is ahead of them. So we're planning to have a special prayer next Sunday for the children who will be returning back to school. In the month of October and November, about 2 months ago, I felt the Lord laying this on my heart to start a series of messages on the family, on the Christian family, the responsibility of the husband, the responsibility of the wife, how we can raise our children. And Lord willing, in the month of October and November, this is what I'm going to be sharing with you from the Word of God, a series of messages on the family. I believe that strong families make strong churches, and strong churches make strong nations and strong neighborhoods. God wants us to build our, have our families build strong on the sure foundation that is Jesus Christ. So plan to be with us in October and November, and of course December, I don't have to tell you what we'll do. The whole month of December, we are going to have Christmas-related messages. Okay? All right, so here is the verse that I want to share with you, and we'll bring before you some nuggets, some truths from the Word of God. For to me to live is Christ, and you fill in the blank, and to die is gain. How about if we all say it together for the glory of God? For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. By the way, these are the words of the Apostle Paul, one of the greatest statements, I believe, ever recorded for us in the Bible, in the Word of God. It is the statement that Paul made in the book of Philippians 1:21, which is our sermon text, message text for this morning. For to me to live is Christ. Let this sink in your heart. Meditate upon these words. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. I was thinking about this. I was imagining Paul and me and the Holy Spirit in my study room this week. And it seemed as if I was even talking to Paul, and I believe that if Paul was there, and if I would have asked Paul, what do you live for? What is your mission statement? What is your business card? What do you want people to know you by? What excites you? What motivates you? What is the meaning of your existence? I believe with all of my heart that this is what Paul would have told us. You want to know who I am? You want to know what I am about? You want to know what I live for? When I put on my shoes in the morning, for me to live is Christ. When I go to work, for me to live is Christ. When I am in my lunch break, for me to live is Christ. When I come home, for me to live is Christ. Before I go to bed, for me to live is Christ. This was the mission statement of Apostle Paul. I believe that with all of my heart. I have a question for you this morning. What is your mission statement? Come on. Life is more than waking up in the morning and going to work and eating a good meal and having a birthday, an anniversary. By the way, today we are celebrating the birthdays, as far as I know, of two men whom we love from the church. I'm not going to mention them. One of them is saying, don't do it, and I'm not going to do it. Okay, I learned my lesson, but anyway, life is more than that. I love birthdays. I love celebrations. I love gathering in the church parking lot and have fun. But life is more than that. What is your mission statement? Paul says, here is my mission statement. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Some of you may say, okay, Pastor, easy for Apostle Paul to say that. I mean, he was Apostle Paul. Oh, really? Not that easy. In fact, when you look in the scripture and you put the scripture together and you connect the dots, you will learn that Apostle Paul, man, when he wrote the book of Philippians, you know where he was? You do, don't you? He was in prison. He was facing possible death. We know that he was chained to a soldier 24 hours a day. The shift will change every 6 hours. And in spite of that, church, he never lost his joy, no matter how sorrowful the circumstances might have been. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 10, Apostle Paul says, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. Poor, yet making many rich. Having nothing, yet possessing all things. Man, I don't know about you, but that's what I want my resume to look like. Amen? Do you want your resume to look like that? He lost his freedom, but he never lost his focus. He never lost his faith. Okay? So, for me, Apostle Paul says, to live is Christ and to die is gain. So here is something for me and you to think about this morning. I told you I have a challenge for you and an encouragement. For me to live is blank. Let the Holy Spirit reveal to you what that is now. And to die is blank. Here are some questions. What is the thing that marks your life? We know what marked Apostle Paul's life, but salvation is personal. Walking with the Lord is personal. What is the thing that marks your life? What are you about? Apostle Paul says, for me to live is Christ, people, and to die is gain. And as I thought about this and as I meditated upon this verse, I like to learn. I pray every day for the Holy Spirit to reveal things to me. I don't want to be dry. I don't want to be too deep either, because in church we have all kinds of groups of people. But I asked the Lord, Lord, I want to know, what would Paul have meant when he said these beautiful words, for me to live is Christ. God revealed to me, what would have Paul meant when he made this awesome statement, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And the more I asked the Lord this question, the more I meditated upon this word, the Lord reminded me to go back to chapter 1, Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Pay attention, please. And in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, Apostle Paul says this, being confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you is going to complete it. Okay? And then I paused and I say, okay, Lord. So in order for me to be able to say, for me to live is Christ, this doesn't happen overnight. This doesn't happen automatically. The Bible says that by nature we are sinners. We are bent to do what is evil. There is no unrighteous, not even one person. So in order for me to be able to say this, and not just to say this, but to live this out, for me to live is Christ. Ooh, then I connect the dots and I go back and I trace everything back to a good work that God has started in me. He who began a good work in me will complete it. So there is a starting point and there is a finish point, finish line. So then I said, okay, Lord, so the starting point in which you began a good work in Paul, I was reminded by the Lord, was that time when Paul was on the road to Damascus. Remember that story? And what was he doing? He was terrorizing people, church. He was a terrorist. You see, we say a lot of things about the terrorists, and I am with you. I think that what they are doing, it is an evil work. We condemn the sense of the terrorist. We condemn the white supremacy. In the kingdom of God, there is no black, there is no white, there is no yellow. There is no, I am a doctor, you are a sweeper. There is no such thing. Right? Right? So we condemn these acts of terrorism. but we ought to love them. We hate the sin, but we love the people. Amen, church? Okay, so Paul was terrorizing people prior to knowing Christ. And on that road to Damascus, he was killing people. On the road to Damascus, Christ revealed himself to Paul. And that was the starting point, church, in which Christ began literally to do a good work in him. Even prior to that, I believe that Christ was arranging all things. Okay? So here is the idea. When Paul got saved, Christ began a good work in him, right? And Christ basically gave him life. Jesus says in the Gospel of John, I have come that you might have life and have it, you fill in the blanks, more abundantly. So when Paul, again, got saved, he received eternal life, abundant life. Somebody said that you can take Buddha out of Buddhism and still have Buddhism. You can take Muhammad out of Islam and you can still have Islam. But here is the thing. You cannot take Christ out of Christianity and still have Christianity. Do you know why? Because Christ lived in John Todor. Glory be to his name. Amen, church? Paul says he is the source of my joy in the midst of my crisis. He's the source of my preaching, right? The very source of my life. This is what I believe that Paul meant when he said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. The very source of my life is Jesus Christ. And here is a man, again, who is in prison and he's not complaining about his chains, but he has consecrated his chains to God and asked God to use him for the furtherance of his kingdom. It is an application for us this morning. Some of you may feel like you are in a dungeon, in a prison of some sorts. Maybe a tough job, maybe a difficult boss. It may be an unbelieving spouse. It could be unsaved parents. It could be that you're suffering from singleness. It could be an illness. Whatever that prison is, you and God know that. And I'm here to remind you this morning that you have two choices. According to the Word of God, choice number one, you can complain. You can gripe. You can put it under the carpet. You can blame God. You can get depressed. Or you can say this morning, like Apostle Paul, God, I'm going to, with the power of the Holy Spirit that is in me, I'm going to rise above the circumstances of life. And I'm going to say, like Paul said in another passage in the scripture, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Would you do that this morning? God, I am going to rise above the circumstances of life, and I'm going to say, like Apostle Paul this morning, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. I'm going to say, like Paul this morning, that greater is the one who is in me. Satan, you are a loser. You've been defeated on the cross by the blood of Jesus Christ. The one who is in me and in us, the children of God, is greater than the one who is in the world. Amen, church? For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. The very source of my life, Paul said, is Jesus Christ. Christ alone is my inspiration. Christ alone is my direction. Christ alone is my meaning. He is my purpose. I am consumed by Christ. I am dominated by Christ. If the gospel of Jesus Christ advances, I am happy. If Jesus Christ is proclaimed, I am happy. If the Lord is magnified in my body and in my weaknesses and in my illnesses and in my trials, then that's what I am all about. For to me To live is Christ, and to die is gain. Here are a few questions for you this morning to consider before you go home. A challenge. Who is the source of your life? Come on, let's deal with this today. Who is the source of your life? Are you able to say this morning, like Apostle Paul, for to me to live is Christ, and not just to say like him, but to mean it, to experience this? Are you able to say that this morning? Let me ask you a more direct question. Have you given your heart to the Lord? It's not enough to be a fan of God. It is not enough to be someone who knows about God. I read a book not a long time ago, a follower and not a fan. Many fans are out there, man. I told you this before in one of the messages. Fans are there for the show. When everything is cool, I am cool. When the team is winning, I am winning. When the going gets tough, they are gone. But the followers are right there, day and night, constant, faithful, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that their labor is not in vain. So have you given your heart to the Lord? And some of you may say, okay, Pastor, I kind of heard this before, but I never know what it meant. Let me explain it to you very briefly in 5 minutes. 1, 2, 3, 4 steps. By the way, do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? From the Bible, let me give you 4 steps. Step number 1, you need to know that God loves you and God has a plan for you. You are not a victim. You are not a loser. The Bible says that the righteous can fall and they can rise again because God is giving them power. You are a conqueror. God has a beautiful plan, even for that terrorist. God wants them saved, and I'm praying for them. I hate what they do. I condemn what they do, but I'm praying for the terrorists. I'm praying for the white supremacists that they come to know Christ. God has a plan for you. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. A life that is complete and full of purpose and meaning. Here is step number 2. There is a problem. The problem is the Bible says that man is sinful and separated from God. Romans 3:26 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's the problem. And the result of that sin is death. The Bible calls the spiritual death, eternal separation from God. We believe in this church that according to the Bible, there are only 2 places where people can go after they die. 2 destinations, either heaven or hell. We believe in a literal heaven and a literal hell. I don't care what anybody else is out there. Okay? The result of sin, is death. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. God has a standard, by the way. God loves sinners, but he hates sin. And you know what God's standard is? Perfection. Be holy, God says, as I am holy. That's the problem. Thank God that I have good news too this morning. There is a solution to mankind's problem. Here is step number 3. The Bible says that God sent his Son to die for your sins. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrated his love towards us in that while we were still sinners, what happened, church? Christ died for us. Isn't that a big praise to the Lord? And that didn't end at the cross. The Bible says that he was put in a grave, and on the 3rd day he rose from the grave. And we serve a risen Savior who is in the world today. I know that he's living, whatever man may say. For me to live is Christ, amen, church? That's the solution. The Bible says that he is the only way to God, the only way to heaven. There is only one mediator between man and God. Not the pastor, not the Pope, not the Baptist, not the Assemblies of God, not the Catholics, not the Missionary Alliance Church, not the Lutherans. That man, capital M, is Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Glory be to his name. Amen? Man is sinful. God sent his son to die for your sins. What do you need to do? Here is step number four. Receive God's forgiveness. So many verses I could have given you here. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, you know, you all know that verse. For by grace you have been saved. By faith. It is the gift of God, not of works, so that no man should boast. So, Pastor, what do I need to do? Just receive it. If I would give you the keys of a brand new car right now, I'm not going to because I'm not able to, but I'm just giving you an example. If I had a brand new Cadillac in the parking lot, the keys right here in my pocket, right? And I'll say, here, this is my gift to you. But Pat, let me give you some money. Let me make some payments. No, this is my gift to you. You're either going to take it or you're going to leave it. A gift is a gift. Can I please go back to my, thank you so much. Okay, so receive God's forgiveness. How do I receive it? Well, believe that you are a sinner. Believe that Christ died for your sins. By faith, ask God and Christ to forgive you from your sins. And the Bible says, then turn away from your sins. And that's called repentance. And Jesus Christ will love you and he will accept you. And the Bible says that he will adopt you into his family as his beloved son and his beloved daughter. What do you need to do? You can pray a simple prayer. I'm just going to give you an example. Dear Lord, I am a sinner. You don't have to pray this prayer, but the same way I do now, but I'm just giving you an example of what you could pray like. I am a sinner. I have sinned against you. In thought, in word, and in deed, I ask you now to forgive my sins. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for me. Thank you for raising Jesus from the dead for my salvation. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and be my Savior. Guide my life and guide my heart so that I can do your will. Thank you for coming in, and now make me the kind of person that you want me to be. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. That's a simple, remember, there is no magic in saying certain words. It is believing in your heart that matters. Amen. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Let me go back a little bit to this, and then we are going to adjourn. Would you please fill in for me? It is for you, but do this for me this morning as I'm challenging. God is challenging you through me. Fill in that blank this morning. For me to live is blank. What is it? And to die is, what is it? Here is the deal. If for me to live is money, then to die is to leave it all behind. And I know millionaires who had billions of dollars and millions of dollars in their bank accounts. And when they died, they were terrified. They were terrified. If for me to live is money, then to die is to leave it all behind, to be a loser. If for me to live is fame, and then to die, it will be to be forgotten when I die. If for me to live is power, then to die is to lose it all. Here is what I want you to know this morning. If you put anything in that first blank, if you put anything in that first blank other than Christ, then I will tell you right now what the second blank will be. Loss. L-O-S-S. Because only Jesus Christ can give meaning to life and make life worth living. Amen. And the only way death can be a gain for us is if we live for Christ. Amen, church. William Carey, one of the famous missionaries that I love and adore, and I can read his biography over and over and over again, and I will never get tired and bored of it. Here is what he said before he died. He said, when I am gone, say nothing about William Carey. Speak only about William Carey's Savior. Speak only about William Carey's Savior. Let's bow down in prayer and let's pray. Father, our hearts are rejoicing today because you love us so much. And God, we long to live in the power of the Holy Spirit. Help us to get where Paul was when he said that living is Christ and dying is gain. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you please stand as we close with a powerful song? And after we sing the song, I'm going to ask Brother Dale Phelps to close us in prayer. I have some baptism certificates for the people who got baptized. I'll give them after the service. Some of them are not here anymore. Okay, so what number do we have here? 510, verses 1 and 2. Remember that day. And if you are not saved, let this day be that day. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy, I am telling he made all my heart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at a cross the Savior sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine. Justified fully through Calvary's love, oh, what a standing is mine. The transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came, took up the offer of grace, he did proffer, praise be his name. Heaven came down and heaven my soul. When at a cross my Savior
Father, what a glorious day that was. Yes. When we invited Jesus into our life to be our Savior, the beginning of a life filled with meaning and purpose. Yes. We praise you and thank you for those who demonstrated their love for you and their faith in you through the waters of baptism this morning. We pray that you would encourage them, help them to continue to grow in their walk with you. And Lord, I pray that if there's anyone here this morning that is not sure where they're going to spend eternity, that they would ask you to be their Savior today. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.